I rise in opposition to this resolution, not because I am taking sides and picking who the bad guys are and who the good guys are, but I'm looking at this more from the angle of being a United States citizen and American.
You just never heard this logic from someone who's actually going to run the country.
This is a powerful message, especially after the war has been going on and the people wake up and realize how many people die and how much it costs.
Congressman Paul, I believe you are the only man on the stage who opposes the war in Iraq, who would bring the troops home as quickly as almost immediately, sir. Are you out of step with your party? Is your party out of step with the rest of the world? If either of those is the case, why are you seeking its nomination?
Well, I think the party has lost its way because the conservative wing of the Republican Party always advocated a non-interventionist foreign policy. Senator Robert Taft didn't want to be in NATO. George Bush won the election in year 2000 campaigning on a humble foreign policy. No nation building, no policing of the world. Republicans were elected to end the Korean War. The Republicans were elected to end the Vietnam War. There's a strong tradition of being anti-war in the Republican Party. It is the constitutional position. It is the advice of the founders to follow a non-interventionist foreign policy. Stay out of entangling alliances. Be friends with countries. Negotiate and talk with them and trade with them. Just think of the tremendous improvement relationship with Vietnam. We lost 60,000. And then we came home in defeat. Now we go over there and invest in Vietnam. So there's a lot of merit to the advice of the founders and following the Constitution. And my argument is that we shouldn't go to war so carelessly. When we do, the wars don't end. Non-intervention was a major contributing factor. Have you ever read about the reasons they attacked us? They attack us because we've been over there. We've been bombing Iraq for 10 years. We've been in the Middle East. I think Reagan was right. We don't understand the irrationality of Middle Eastern politics. So right now we're building an embassy in Iraq that's bigger than the Vatican. We're building 14 permanent bases. What would we say here if China was doing this in our country or in the Gulf of Mexico? We would be objecting. We need to look at what we do from the perspective of what would happen if somebody else did it to us.
Ron Paul joining us now to let us know what he thinks of this bill as we look at it. That, Congressman, is a heck of a lot of pork, isn't it?
It sure is. It's pretty amazing. You take a bad bill and make it a lot worse, and you get 57 members of Congress switching from no to yes. So that tells you something about Washington. There's really not much hope for us here in D.C. to solve the problems. It's just more of the same, more of the spending. You know, they're dealing with this. There is a financial crisis and a credit crunch, but they're not dealing with the fact that this country is bankrupt. And we're on the verge of some really major events, but we're adding fire to the fuel.
Nation to be overtaxed, overregulated, and overrun by bureaucrats. The founders would be ashamed of us.
A long, long time ago, I can still...
People of color in this country, don't be afraid. We cannot vote for people based on the color of their skin. We cannot vote for people based on their gender. We have to look at the truth. This war on drugs is killing our children. It's killing our families. It's killing our communities. This war on guns is killing our children. It's killing our families. There are too many nonviolent of our men sitting in prison. There are too many black women without husbands because young black boys are struggling in school. We need the education system turned back over to the states, and we need to get rid of these federal crimes so we can build our families back and love each other and take care of each other. Don't be afraid. Take a stand. Believe in the truth.
I really can't. We're almost out of time, but I want to get to your immigration platform. You're calling for action and not talk, and here's a couple of points for our viewers that you want. You want to physically secure our borders and coastlines, enforce visa rules, no amnesty, no welfare for illegal aliens. You want to end the birthright citizenship and pass true immigration reform. Would true immigration reform include a guest worker program in your judgment?
Well, you know, those words are tricky because sometimes if you say for a guest worker program, all of a sudden they construe that now, the conventional wisdom is that there will be amnesty. No, we've always had workers come to this country, but they have to be legal. And we have to deal with the welfare state. We can't allow the illegal immigrants to qualify for Social Security after working here for 18 months. We just flat out can't afford it.
Thank you very much for laying it out so clearly for us, Representative Ron Paul. Thank you.
And then in the Depression, what did we try to do? We tried to fix prices, which is exactly what we're doing now. We would not, in the Depression, allow wages to go down, and we said, well, the price of farm products has to stay up. So in doing that, we plowed crops under, and people were starving. And I don't think we gained a whole lot of wisdom since we were plowing under crops to keep prices up. Because now we're talking about illiquid assets, and we're talking about price fixing. And we're talking about somebody in the government and the Federal Reserve and Treasury who does prices. Now, the Austrian School of Economics, which has been around a long time, they predicted the Depression, they predicted the 1970s, the breakdown of Bretton Woods, they predicted all that's happening today. Their key point is, don't mess around with prices. Because if you do, you become socialistic. And this is why Mises predicted the failure of socialism and why it did fail. But here we are in price fixing again. You say that part of your mandate is price stability, but I hardly think price stability comes by price
fixing.
Finally,
Steve Wright from Pennsylvania. Remember the line from the classic Simon and Garfunkel song, The Sound of Silence, the line that says, the words of the prophets are written on the subway walls and tenement halls. When I hear Ron Paul, sometimes I wonder whether I'm not listening to a latter-day prophet with the way he speaks truth about what our nation has come to.
Science said the words of the prophets are written on the subway walls.